explanation or a presentation of why perhaps we have some of the attitudes in police departments around the country. This is something that has been passed down over the years, and it's hopefully the attitudes are being dissipated as officer, or is it sergeant, means presented. We can change things by having the proper attitude. But I want to show you three different videos.
So what's your business with you right now?
I want to find out who you are and what kind of...
There is no problem, that's the thing.
So talk to me.
Let you know who I am is the problem. I know my wife, first off. Secondly, I don't have to let you know who I am if I haven't broken any laws. I told him, I'm going to New Horizons to pick up my kids at 10 o'clock. I was sitting there for 20 minutes. Like, not before he walked up to me or anything. He walked up to me a minute after and got irate with me. So first off, that's a public area. And if there's no sign that doesn't say this is a private area, you can't sit here, no one can tell me I can't sit here. If that's the case, then I can't sit here. The problem is I'm black. That's the problem. No, it really is, and I didn't do anything wrong. I'm not sitting here with a group of people. I'm sitting here by myself. I'm not causing a problem with anyone. There isn't a sign that says this is a private area, you can't sit here. Therefore, you cannot tell me I can't sit there if I'm not doing anything wrong. What's going on, brother? I got to go with my kids.
No. Please don't touch me. Please don't touch me.
No, wait.
Go to jail.
I'm not doing anything wrong.
Can you please?
Come on, brother. This is assault. Can you please?
I'm not here to argue with you.
Wrong, sir.
Put your hands behind your back.
No, can you please?
Put your hands behind your back.
I didn't do anything wrong.
Put your hands behind your back.
Come on, really? I got to go get my kids.
Put your hands behind your back. Otherwise, you can get out.
What do you need from me?
I told you.
Can you get out and let me go?
And identify you.
I told you everything.
The next one will show another encounter with the police. Yes.
Video. sound to start once the it records.
Did you call him?
Show the differences many times of how the black community encounters the police in ways different than the white community encounters the police. That was the reason for showing those videos. What should you do when you're stopped by the police? Many of you are in here, are police officers, so you know how you want people to act when you encounter them. But it's very simple. You know, if you're told to stop, you stop. If you're asked for identification, you give your identification. And after that, you are not required to say anything else. The police officer is going to lead you through whatever process he wants to lead you through. As Officer Wing, correct me.
Terrence is called.
Terrence, our state police representative, indicated that is not the time to educate the police officer about your knowledge of, you know, your Fourth and Fifth and Sixth Amendment rights. He or she doesn't want to hear that at that time. That's not to say you're not going to get arrested, even if you don't ask any questions. But the point is, you want to go home, just like Terrence said. He just wants to go home to his family at night. And we want you, a citizen, if you haven't encountered the police, we want you to go home. We don't want you to get stopped and then go to jail and then go home. And you may not get home, depending on how bad the situation evolves. So arrest, search, and seizure for the common ordinary citizen is to, I would say, stop, identify yourself, look, and listen. Because if you do those things, if the officer has violated your rights, if they are acting improperly, which clearly in some of these videos, the police were acting improperly, you'll be able to deal with it later, because every police department does have a system for dealing with officers who overstep their bounds. I'm not saying that all the systems are effective, but they do exist. So with that, I will close. I know this was pretty intense, but some of this education, some of us have never heard. I have to say that when I was going to school, I went to Catholic schools, we didn't learn any of this. I spent most of my career with the police department. I did investigate police. Well, they called it misconduct. Most of the time it was crimes that police had committed against the citizens. I also investigate attorneys who commit crimes against their clients. So, it's very shocking to learn that these things happen, but they do happen. You've heard it in the news. So with that, I am going to close. I don't know whether this was informative for you, shocking, disgusting, but I felt that it might be important to give this back to you.
Okay, I'm going to ask Officer Wings, Byron, and Paula, would you sit at the table? Bobby, I'm going to ask that you would leave.
It's already on. That was a nice way to go.
Leave the table.
Oh, I don't have to leave?
No.
Okay. Just the table. If
you all don't know who that gentleman is, that August gentleman is there, that's Robert Cotton, our councilman for the city of Valparaiso. So, thank you for being here, Robert.
I got it, man.
Okay, so if you don't want to take another break, we can begin our question and answer plenary session now. And remember, we're talking about implicit bias, we're talking about police behaviors, and we're talking about protocols in terms of stopping and search and seizure protocol. So, does anyone have a question to start us off? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question for our last presenter. My question is, I know you said you were Chicago PD for 18 years. Why did you choose to leave Chicago PD and kind of, like you say, go to the other side?
I think that, well, first of all, I was an attorney, and I mean, I am still an attorney, but I was offered a position, what I would consider a better position with the Public Defender's Office in Cook County. But there were also some things going on that had really nothing to do with the police department. I was detailed to another department, and the police departments, as they are, have politics. So the politics have changed the police department. I thought it was best for me to make the switch.
Directed towards buyers. I know in your presentation you talked about taking addresses off of resumes and zip codes and things like that. But if we tend to do that, isn't we helping the buyers stay afloat if we're doing that? Because we bring them off and then, like Sergeant said, he's from Gary, he might not put that on there. But how do we change our perception?
That was a joke, I'm proud of you.
Okay, but how do we change other people's perception of Gary or the West Side of Chicago or any city communities?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. Like I said, this week, this was presented by others. I would say the difference is that was recognition on how to get in the door. Regardless of whether you take your address off or not, that's still where you're from. So the difference is, do you have a job in this place that is specifically biased because you're able to get into the door? Now you have a job, now you can present and say, hey, I'm from Gary, or I'm from South Dallas, I'm from Oak Cliff, and I made it, I'm doing well. Like, you see, the products that are coming out of this area. And so I think the only thing that's going to help alleviate bias is, like I said, positive interactions that act in the reverse nature or the inverse nature of the thing that caused the bias. And so without that positive relationship, without that positive interaction, without that positive intervention, the people that have the bias won't be socialized in a different way. And so the goal is to actually get in to actually have that relationship, because the relationship doesn't come from the resume. It comes from the people actually being able to have the position, being able to have those conversations. And so the goal is to get in the door. And that's the main piece. Yes.
And I'm sorry, real quick, and to also add to what you said, education is very important. If I were to tell you that over the last 15, 16 years, if I gave you the number of murders that occurred in the city of Gary, you'd be like, wow, that's a lot for a city that size. But if I turned around and I told you, this is why I say education is so important, if I told you that a particular area of Gary had no homicides in a 15, 20 year period, I think that would change how you see Gary, right? If I showed you on a map where you have the homicide, and if I showed you that there's a cluster here, a cluster here, a cluster there, over that entire 20-year period, I think it would change what people know and believe about Gary. And then I gave you the demographics of those who were murdered. That every article, for the most part, at that time was negative about the city of Gary. So our social activism was to, you know what, we're not going to pay you for this mess. And so that's what we did. And if we, as a community, let not just the newspaper, but let the television stations, let the news, they put certain things, just like in one of the first videos that we saw, is to grab your attention, right? And they do that. And the reason they do that is to grab your attention. You can hear a story without seeing a face, without hearing, without knowing. It can be done right. Not knowing the race of that person, but the way that they describe the act, you know whether that person was white, black, or Latino. So if we
As a consumer, we let, whether it be the newspaper or the media, know that we are not, I don't like this, right? And the only way that they know that we like this is in, right now, the way that technology is, you hit on a website, you hit on that particular YouTube page, you replay that, you send it to somebody, that's a like. That means that you like this type of stuff, so I'm going to continue to play it. So if we we have to educate those that have the ability to stop with the negative and now show something positive about it. I'm sorry, that was a long way to say education.
I have a question to the panel. Anybody can answer. This is my concern about implicit bias. If an individual is working inside his or her bias, and I'm traumatized and working inside my bias based on the trauma, and we meet on the street, I mean, what are my options?
What do you mean?
I mean, if there's an officer inside his bias or her bias, I'm inside mine because I've been traumatized either in the past or, you know, with that. But certainly when I'm getting stopped, I have some stereotypical expectations about what the drama is going to unfold. How does one navigate that?
Well, I like I said, the thing is, it depends on what your goal is. If your goal is to get to your destination, the best thing for you to do is to follow the officer's instructions and to the letter. And if you believe that there was something improper, then deal with it later. It's just like the law of the workplace. If you don't like something that's happening on your job, and your supervisor tells you to do something, you obey first and you complain later. So that's how
to the point of being physically traumatized?
Well, are you saying that the officer
I'm saying somebody twisted your arm. I mean, you know, or doing something that they shouldn't be doing. Based out of that bias. How do you navigate that?
What am I right now?
You're a police officer.
Okay, and I drive a police car. Right? I've been stopped by the police driving a police car. The police have been called on me in rural areas. Hey, I see a state trooper car. There's a black guy in a state trooper uniform. Is he a trooper? Did somebody steal one of your cars? Right? So somebody has to be the adult. Right? I have to be the adult in that situation. Right? You can't twist my arm if I'm not resisting.
Okay.
Right? If I come over there and I put your arm behind your back, the only way that your arm gets twisted, the only way that ligament damage occurs, I'm not a doctor or anything, but generally, the only time that ligament damage is going to occur or some trauma to your body is going to occur is if you are resisting at that point. If you allow, if they're doing something wrong, believe me, you will be well compensated. Right? Unfortunately, you have to go through that, but what I'm saying is, generally, and I'm going to say generally.
I'm with you.
Generally, those type of interactions don't occur without something precipitating that. Generally, an interaction that goes from me not liking you and you not liking me to hands-on, something has to occur. And if we have an adult in that situation, whether it be the police officer or whether it be the citizen, since that's the route you decided to take, if we have an adult in that situation, we can forego all of that.
Are we saying that, and I know there's police officers here, and I'm not talking about the 99% here. I'm talking about the 1%, you know, people who might have some problems.
Right.
But is it possible for an officer to operate inside his or her bias and not meet the level of professional response that he or she needs to have in terms of that interaction?
Well, that's possible.
Well, right, and I think what you're asking is, so if